again, let's look at Romans 8, verse 26, a familiar passage, and if it's not, well, then let it be so. A wonderful, wonderful text. So let's hear God's word. And I meant to say, and I think it's appropriate, even as I look at these first few verses, this isn't going to be a really long sermon that I'm aware of, unless God moves otherwise, but it's to prepare our hearts for prayer. So after I finish preaching, Pastor Rollo is going to come up and lead us in prayer. That's the focus this morning. So remember that as we now read these verses. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he will glorify, and has done so. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time. We pray for each one here listening to this, and we pray for those that weren't able to listen. Oh, I even pray for those who are expecting to come and couldn't. Oh, be with them. Give us comfort in Jesus Christ. Help us to remember his promises, to cling to them now. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we've been going through this stressful time, I will admit that a lot of my thoughts are going back to when I was in the Army and went through a lot of stressful times. Phil's saying, why are you shaking your head? It's coming through, right? Okay. When I was in the Army and went under a lot of stress there, and I'm probably going to talk about it a lot these next few weeks. So if nothing else, everything's going to feel normal at Grace Covenant. But the memory that comes to mind today was 1 month after Kirsten and I got married, I woke up and there was a little 2-inch article on the bottom of the front page of the paper that said Iraq invaded Kuwait. 2 inches. And I said, that's it. I mean, after all our tanks and other vehicles were already painted desert brown. Our division in Georgia, his job was to go to the Middle East, and I knew, and certainly it was confirmed within 3 days that we were going. We were given 3 weeks to pack up all our stuff and get ready to go into what would certainly be a war, and eventually did become one. And as we went through all this, just working really hard at trying to get all our vehicles ready, getting all the equipment, making sure the supply lines were flowing, our colonel wanted to make sure we took care of ourselves. So we said, every third day you get off, go spend time with your family. Take care of yourself. And that's a practical thing I want for us to remember as well. But I was getting scared. And here's what I was scared of. I was scared, not so much of getting hurt. I was scared that I would not do my duty when it came time to battle. And so I went to go meet with the chaplain one-on-one in his office. These ugly little buildings that they gave us. And I said to him, chaplain, he was a great godly man, a Baptist minister who did such a good job with us. And I said to him, I'm scared. I'm scared of what will happen in 3 months. And he said, Chris, God never promises to give you strength ahead of the time. What he promises is to meet your need on the day. Otherwise, you wouldn't need to pray. You wouldn't need to depend on him. You would store it up. But when the time comes, God will be there for you. Brothers and sisters, we have a lot to fear, especially if you're watching too much news. And unless you're a health official with a lot of decision-making ability, I suggest you don't do that. Keep touch with the latest updates once a day, twice a day. But there's nothing much we can do to change the outcome other than prayer. And to be careful ourselves, and we've talked about some of the health concerns and doing our societal-wide part of flattening the curve. But you might be afraid personally that you might get sick, or you might be afraid for family members living elsewhere that they might get sick. You might be afraid of harming others, that you'd make a mistake. That's been my fear, that I would do something that would cause harm to others. You might be afraid economically or financially. We're beginning to hear reports of people losing jobs and losing business. Or you're watching the news and saying, surely a recession is coming. Again, all of that is beyond our control. You may be fearful looking at the situations of other countries and rightfully mourning with them, hurting with them, and that's good. There's a lot that if we depended on our own flesh and on the world, we have to fear. That is true. I don't want to dodge that. But that is also why we have God's word. And so this morning, I just want to remind us of four comforts pretty briefly this morning. And the first one, just very simply, we're just going to read the scriptures. The first one is those first couple of verses that made me pause at first. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we don't know how to pray. But the Spirit, this is God. The Holy Spirit is God. He himself is praying for us and in us and helping us. And also, in a sense, interceding for us. So we've got God on our side. It's not just Jesus Christ on the cross and in his resurrection that we'll talk about in a moment, but God himself in our midst, praying for us, helping us. It's okay to know your weakness. You don't have to pretend like you've got it all together and that you know what to do and how to pray. Let's be gentle with each other. Even this morning, I was not as gentle as I could be with people because I'm trying to tell them what to do. Let's depend upon the Holy Spirit to pray for us and to comfort us. That's the first comfort. The second one is this famous verse that you might have already memorized. It's verse 28. For we know that for all who love God, all things work together for good. That's a promise. It's not just good things that work together for good, but all things, including economic difficulties, including illnesses. If you are in Christ, then God promises somehow to use it for good. Now, it would be an abuse of my authority to tell you specifically what that will be for you. I can suggest things later on, like the psalmist. You can look back and say, look at how God has been faithful to me. But right now, our only call is to believe this promise. Now, if you look carefully at the verse, it actually is not for every last human. It's for those that have been called by God and who trust Christ. And then that leads to the logic of the next comfort, the next few verses. And so, yes, your neighbor may not have this promise, and it's your job to pray for them to receive this promise, to know that God can work out all things together for good. But that's only through Jesus Christ. And so that's the second comfort. God is sovereign. He's got this. The third comfort is the gospel itself. This is the logic for everything Paul's written so far. And just look at these wonderful verses, 29 through 30. Again, great verses to memorize. Theologians call this, what do they call this? The ordo salut, the golden chain of salvation. Something in Latin also, I don't know. But just to look at the order here. God, verse 29, he foreknows, he puts his love upon those that he will save. He then predestines them, so it's his choice. And then, having done that, he's going to conform you to the image of his Son, make you more holy. That's maybe what it means to work out all things together for good. And then, verse 30, if he has predestined you, he calls you by his Holy Spirit, and then he justifies you. And here's the promise. If he has justified you, that's the gospel. We'll talk about that in a moment. If he has justified you, then he will glorify you. In fact, Paul says he has glorified you. If you have been justified, there is no way that you will not enter into heavenly glory. If God has set his love upon you in Christ, there's nothing that can take that away from you. That's the good news. Now, what is justification? Well, some of you know this. It goes all the way back. I'm just going to do this simply, quickly, because my voice is running out. We want to leave time for prayer. But basically, at the beginning of the book of Romans, Paul says that the righteous, which means you will be forgiven, will live by faith. That we don't have to do enough good things for God to forgive us. We can't. Rather, all we need to do is trust in what Jesus has done for us. As Paul says in chapter 4, to the man who does not work. So you're not doing enough good things, but trust God who justifies the wicked. His faith is credited as righteousness. Do you see that? So if you're not doing enough good things, which you aren't, but you trust God to save you through Jesus Christ, then that faith counts as perfect righteousness. You're going to heaven straight up. I don't care your denomination. I don't care your sins. I don't care your worries. Christ has got you. He's forgiven you. Therefore, Paul goes on in Romans 5, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I remember years ago talking to an older member in our church who has since passed away and since seen his glory. His name was Dave Hogue. He used to sit right back there. He's from Bluefield. I'd say Bluefield, Virginia, or West Virginia. You'd get very indignant. Bluefield, Virginia. We don't want anything to do with West Virginia. So Scott, I don't know if you're listening to this, but you get that. Scott's a guy who played for both high schools on both sides, so you can ask him about that later. But Dave was a private man. He didn't like to talk much about his life. The only way I could get him talking was about the Hokies, because he graduated in like 1960, or maybe politics. Then he'd get going, so I tried to stay away from that. But here's the thing. Even in his old age, when I would visit him in the nursing home down in Salem, I would read to him passages like this. I'd tell him that he was saved in Christ, and he wouldn't say anything. All he would do is close his eyes, lift up his hands, and nod. My friends, that's faith. That's receiving God's grace. And if you do that, nothing will take that away from you. So that's the third comfort, the comfort of the sure forgiveness of God through Jesus Christ. And then that leads to this final comfort. This I'm just going to flip ahead to verse 35, these wonderful verses. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? In other words, let me back up. If God is for us, who can be against us? And therefore, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, sword? Can anything separate you from God's love? And Paul says, no. In fact, even if you're getting persecuted, no. Then he says, in fact, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Now, by more than conquerors, I don't think he means like we're supermen, right? I don't think he's like, yeah, we got this, and we're going to sail through disease like it's not going to. No, we actually might get in trouble. We might suffer in various ways. I'm pretty sure many of us will, one way or another, through this. If nothing else, bearing up the trials of others. No, we're more than conquerors, because in this, we're being conformed to the image of Christ. We're becoming more like him. And we have the assurance of eternal life that one day we will fly like Superman in heaven. And I've always said, I'm going to try, and if it doesn't work, I'm going to fall to the ground, and it's not going to hurt, and we'll all laugh at me. It's fine. But until then, we're more than conquerors because we have the Holy Spirit within us. And we're responding. Instead of anger and fear and anxiety, we take those to the Lord in our weakness. And then we respond instead with faith, with hope, and with love. And so Paul then says at the end, I am sure that neither death nor life or angels or rulers or anything present, height nor depth, anything in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Even if we die, we will be with Christ. In fact, that's the way we get to be with Christ. If we always prayed for good health and God always answered it, we'd just be like, 1,000 years old and be miserable because, you know. No. One day God's going to answer our prayers by letting us go home. But nothing separates us from his love. Oh, death, where is your sting? Death is swallowed up in victory. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. As Peter writes, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth from a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. For though we have not seen Christ, you love him. And even though you don't see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. You are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. My friends, that's the hope we have. Those are the four comforts that are in this text for us. I'll fast forward now to the end of the little war I was in back in 1991. And you probably know, if you're old enough, you know the history that the ground combat only lasted 4 days. Honestly, we were in more danger from shooting ourselves than from the enemy in most sectors. But after the war had settled down and the president had declared a ceasefire, everybody was just kind of chilling. It was like, it's over. We're just joking around. And we had some of our units kind of behind these sand berms and just messing around. And I think one of the captains had brought out his guitar and was playing. And all of a sudden, we got word over the radios that an Iraqi force was coming our way. And so it was tanks, apparently, a large group of tanks coming, and we didn't know why. So I was running around doing my job as a young lieutenant, making sure people were doing what they were supposed to do. And that's kind of how I felt this past week, a little frantic. Put your helmet on. Put your flak vest on. Go up to the berm. Man that machine gun. I mean, I didn't even have any machine guns in my unit, but some mechanics did. Go man that machine gun. Get ready. And as I'm running around trying to get people to take it seriously, I run past the chaplain's Humvee. And I'll never forget this. That same chaplain. Do you know what he was doing? What do you think? He was on his knees praying. He knew that God had this. I was doing my job, but he was doing his. And brothers and sisters, you have jobs to do out there in your families and out there in your workplaces. Keep doing them safely as you're able to. But don't forget your job as a Christian and as a church member. And that is to give this to God and to pray which we're going to do just now, and to be comforted through this time. The Holy Spirit is helping you through your weakness. God's going to work all this together for your good as you trust Christ. You're saved. You're justified by His blood. Nothing changes that. And then finally, even if, when for each of us death comes, whenever that is, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ. Let's pray. Father, we wish we could be together in person, but we thank You that Your word abides and is powerful, that Your Spirit is here as we worship You in spirit and in truth. Oh, Father, please comfort each of us with Your gospel. Use this for good, and hear us now as we lift up Your church, this world, and our neighbors to You in prayer. In Christ's name.